So we have the privilege of welcoming Duncan up onto the platform tonight to come and preach. So why don't you just stand and welcome him? Come on. Woo. You know, it's 10 years ago last week that we met you in Lytham St. Anne's, I think it was. Yeah, the leaders' school. And when we met Duncan Kate, we just fell in love with him straight away. You're off the charts, incredible. You've taught us so much, you've taught the world so much, but you've just stretched us and helped us grow, and we are eternally grateful. You're amazing, Duncan Kate. Thank you so much, and so excited to hear what God's going to say. Yeah. Amen.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much, Chloe. You all may be seated. And, I think I'm just going to ask those of you that are up at the front that can go back to your seats, to go back to your seats. And those of you who can't go back to your seats, just get down on the floor. And prayer ministry team, you're welcome to stay and soak them. But Hi, everybody. I found out in March this year that Kate and I are going to become grandparents in December. And wow. When our eldest Jess first told us, she just graduated from UNC Chapel Hill. She's married to Aaron Ninneber, who's our youth pastor in Raleigh. He's a graduate from the Bethel Supernatural School of Ministry, and he's also an amazing son of this house. And this he's from Ontario, Canada. And Aaron's just an amazing man of God. He's the kind of, although Kate and I have three daughters, if we'd had a son, I'd like to hope that we'd have raised him as well as Aaron's parents raised him. He's an incredible young man. And Aaron and Jess, they're just one of those couples that are full of life, full of joy, and they're pranksters, you know. So they set the whole thing up to tell Mom and Dad, Kate and I, that we were going to become grandparents and announce the news with joy. And so Kate and I had just flown back from Australia. We'd had a great time with John, and we'd seen God moving in incredible ways. But we were a little bit tired from flying all that way. And Aaron and Jess had got to the house before we arrived, our house, and hidden a camera because they knew that Dad was going to have and Mom were going to have a big reaction. And sure enough, when they told us, Jess stood up and she held up this little tiny pair of pants, and she said, "I went to the store today, and I ended up buying a pair of pants for myself that were too small. I'm thinking of taking them back." And we're like, "Too small? Like that's not even close to being the right." And then we're like, and we just jumped up, and they knew exactly where to put the camera, because they know Jess knows her dad, and she knew I was just going to get up, like I do whenever I'm excited, and just go wandering off, just walking off somewhere, going, "Oh, yeah, 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 yeah," all excited. And sure enough, I did exactly that, and I was just so filled with joy at the thought of becoming a grandfather. It was I can't describe to you how excited I was. And then they told us, after big hugs and everything, and I'd made my way back from across the room, big hugs. And then they said, we have a camera, we hid it, and would you like to see? And I'm like, "Yeah, let's have a look." Woo-hoo! And I got the camera and I'm looking and I was like, "Oh my gosh, That's not the athletic man that I've known, grown up knowing and just so proud of the way I'm just lithe and move so nimbly and so smoothly. I was just shocked by the way I got up off the couch. Oh, hallelujah. I was thinking, what is wrong with you? What's happened to my body? And that plunged me into 3 months of near depression. I just couldn't shake this like kind of funk that was all over me that I'm going to be a grandfather. I'm thinking, how in the world did that happen? I'm going to be a grandfather. And I didn't tell anyone. I didn't even tell Kate. I just had this deep funk. Every time I look in the mirror, I'm like, wow, yeah, there's definitely a lot less hair on the forehead. And whoa, I'd never noticed quite how much gray hair there is now. Oh, wow, wow, and look at those wrinkles, and oh gosh, I'm like, you know. You know, and, that international ministry is getting a little supernaturally global there, Duncan. I need to do something about that, and I was just really, I just couldn't wrap my head around what in the world had happened to me in this whirlwind of discovering I'm going to become a grandfather. And in fact, I'm glad Andrew and Kathy are here, because it wasn't until I got to Medellin, Colombia, where they have one of my all-time favorite churches on the entire planet. They pastor a church of about 8,000 to 9,000 people, everybody, right here. And you know what I love so much about it is that it's 8,000 fanatical, on-fire lovers for Jesus who were not wooed into the church through seeker-sensitive kind of presentation of the gospel. They were presented with the glorious King of the Kingdom and His majesty and the reality that He's... that He absolutely wants to turn your whole life upside down. And you know, meeting Jesus is an unrecoverable moment that you're never the same again. He just wants to put you instantly to death and raise you again, a completely brand new human being who's totally different to the nerd that walked in, you know. I was invited by Andrew and Kathy to go and speak at their youth conference. Can you imagine the irony? And it was one of those invitations that normally, you know, one doesn't invite somebody a month before to go to a youth conference at a church with like 8,000 people. You know, normally they've got it all planned out, and they had it all planned out, but for whatever reason, the person, I think, and this is how I understood it anyway, whether it was right or wrong, but I understood that the person that they were thinking that was going to come, couldn't come, and so then they phoned me, and would you like to come, Duncan? And I'm like, absolutely. And then I'm like, yes, I'm coming. Youth conference, yeah, that's good. Oh, absolutely. I mean, I'm a young youth pastor. What have I said yes to? I'm a grandfather. Yeah, I don't know if you've heard, but something's really changed since you last saw me preaching. I've become a grandfather in December, and I don't know if grandfathers are welcome at this youth conference. And I was just still in my funk. I got to the youth conference, and everybody looked like they were about 5 years old. I was like, what's happened to the youth of our day, you know? Everybody just looks like a child around here. And there was even a few people with children. And I was thinking, you're far too young to have children. What are you doing with children? Anyway, I understand that's something that happens to grandfathers. You know, everybody looks like a kid. Well, anyway, I was in my hotel the first morning. And the second morning, I was in my hotel and I just was... we'd had a great day the day before, and I just was in this place with God. You know, when you're in that place of deep prayer. And that's just for all of you watching on the video. Just was worried you were falling asleep in your couch there. Oh, I love this church. I love it so much. Anyway, I started praying. Hiya, yeah, yeah. Whoa. I started praying. And as I was praying, all of a sudden, the Holy Spirit began to just speak to me so clearly, and he began to show me, Duncan, I'm by no means not even close to being finished with you yet. You're entering into the greatest phase, even as a grandfather. And I just began to, suddenly I got connected with the purpose of my life. And I began to realize I've got the rest of my life to make sure that my grandson and his generation, whatever that generation is going to be called, Gen Z, I don't know what it's going to be called, whatever it's going to be called, that generation of my grandson, that I have the rest of my life to make sure that they are walking in Daddy's love like no other generation, that they're walking in their union with Christ, their oneness with Christ, which is the ultimate intimacy, that union, that oneness with Christ, that they understand the cross of Christ, that they understand the resurrection of Jesus Christ, that they're filled with the gospel of peace, that they're filled with a passion to transform their nations and their cities, that they're walking in the power and the anointing of the Holy Spirit. And I realized, oh God, I'm going to write whatever books I need to write. I'm going to preach whatever sermons need to be preached. I'm going to go to whatever nations need to go. But I give you the rest of my life, God, to ensure that when my fathers have gone to be with you, and it's our day to be those grandfathers and great-grandfathers, the Father, we're not the generation where it all ended, because we didn't pass it on. But we're going to be the generation that's the bridge generation that will make sure that this revival is truly a never-ending revival. So I have fire in my bones again, even if they are grandfatherly bones. Seems crazy. I still look at myself and see this athletic life man. I find it hard to think that I'm going to become a grandfather. Ooh. My pastor's teasing me. I can feel it. Okay. Before I actually get into the sort of, if you like, the meat of the word that I feel like the Lord's given me, I'd like to just share something that the Holy Spirit has shown me just yesterday, actually, and during the worship. How many of you were here yesterday morning during the worship, and you suddenly felt there was like a mega shift, a shift happened in the spirit while Laura and Ruth were singing? And I tell you what, if you weren't there, I just want to say for all of us that were there, that was one of the most outstanding worship sets I've ever had the privilege to be part of. And we were just lost in the glory realm. And you know, I began to see something that I've never seen before. I've been wrestling because I'm a local church pastor. I pastor a church in Raleigh, North Carolina, called Catch the Fire Raleigh-Durham. And my wife and I are the senior leaders of that church. We started it 8 years ago. And we also have the privilege of leading it with my brother and sister and another couple of couples. And my brother and sister Murray and Ash are the lead pastors of the church now and doing an outstanding job. Church has about 500, 550 on a Sunday, maybe about 600 people. 650 people in the whole congregation, so it's really beginning to motor. And God's given us a couple of buildings supernaturally. Our first building was a supernatural provision. We bought it for $1.4 million cash because even though we were only 3.5 years old, God gave us outrageous blessings, like checks like $1,200,000 in the mail that were from anonymous donors. You know, those kinds of sort of regular sort of things that happen to local churches. And, Oh! It's just a whole lot better when Jesus builds his church than when we try to build it. There's no guarantee that the gates of hell won't prevail against what we build. But when we hand over to Jesus and let him build, we don't even have to have a spiritual warfare group of whatever. Because we don't need that kind of spiritual warfare. Jesus makes sure that the gates of hell don't prevail against it. We just get to put our little hands into our daddy's big hands and rest in the goodness of God. And I sometimes feel like I'm a little kid, you know. He's got his little hand in his big daddy's hand, and I'm just going along with him and bumbling along and stumbling into one ridiculous victory after another that I have no idea why is happening. I'm not barely conscious that I'm treading all over serpents and squishing scorpions and, you know, pulling down principalities. I've no idea that I'm doing them. I'm just having the greatest time as a little kid with my dad, you know. It's just awesome. And Murray and Ash, why don't you stand up, say hi to everybody. Murray and Ash are right here. And they're the lead pastors of Catch the Fire, Riley Durham, just doing an amazing job. And also my middle brother, Russ, is here. And Russ is also a mighty man of God and is taking the business arena by storm. And Russ has been recently come back from Victoria, where he and his wife, Jo, were pastoring a church in Victoria. Russ, why don't you stand up as well? Say hi to everybody. My middle brother, Russ. And yeah, my nieces as well. Stand up. That's Ella and Gracie. And Russ and Ella and Gracie and Joe and the whole family are a part of this church right here, Catch the Fire Toronto. And we're really glad they're back from Victoria, British Columbia, because we get to see them a whole lot more often. And you know, when you're immigrants, any family that you can find is really helpful to hang out with. So we're really glad that we get to hang out with them. And all that to say that we've been on a journey in Raleigh, Durham. And in that journey, we've begun to, the Lord has been lifting our eyes and lifting our gaze from the church to the city. And we've been very focused for 8 years on caring for the church, and you need to be if the church is almost dying every week. It's helpful to keep your eyes on it and nurture it and help it grow. But now the church is grown up and is motoring and moving, and the Holy Spirit has been opening our eyes, lifting our gaze and saying, there's more to the kingdom than your church. That's really my church. And I'm not asking you to build the kingdom. It's already nicely built. I'm asking you to seek my kingdom. And I'm asking you to reveal my kingdom. And I'm asking you to manifest my kingdom. And I'm asking you to expand and enlarge my kingdom. And I'm asking you to rule in my kingdom with me. And I want you to begin, and the Lord's been speaking to us as a leadership team, I want you to begin to start changing your messages from being messages that are centered around equipping the saints for the work of ministry, which is all about, you know, equipping them for the prophetic so they can prophesy in church, and equipping them for miracles, signs, and wonders so that they can do miracles, signs, and wonders in church, in their home groups, and in their small groups, and Ignite groups, or whatever else. And the Lord's been saying, you know, that's fine, but stop doing that. I want you to equip them so that they can be the most phenomenal lawyers that are out there, dentists that are out there, you know, whatever it happens to be that's their vocation, I want you to equip them that the anointing of the Holy Spirit, the same anointing that you have to preach, is the same anointing that they can, that can empower them to be phenomenal in their workplace. And that they're not just lawyers so that they can lead people to Jesus in the law firm. But God's called them to be lawyers so that society can have incredible godly anointed lawyers. And I use lawyers, but you can take that and expand it into all the walks of life. Anointed police officers, anointed fire officers, and so on. I was an anointed police officer many years ago. I hope that doesn't lose any friends. But I was one of Her Majesty's police constables in England. I was a bobby. Had my big bobby's hat on. I look like a kid. I mean, I see these pictures of me in my uniform and I'm like, oh my gosh, how in the world did they ever allow me to wear that uniform? I literally looked like I'd stepped out of middle school. And with big Bobby's hat on and, you know, had my truncheon. Yeah, yeah, I had to, unlike in America, you know, where we say, where our police officers, they say, stop or I'll shoot. Actually, right now in America, it's more, oops, I meant to say stop. Well, it's true. Say it like it is. They need a good dose of the British police culture, where the police are a police service, not a police force. Called to serve the community, not be running around forceful, throwing their weight around, and basically being ungodly. Well, actually, murder is murder, whether you're in uniform or not. And so I'm actually glad of my time in uniform, because it gives me an appreciation of just exactly how wrong some things are right now, especially in our nation of the United States of America. And we're praying for all of our communities that God will keep everybody safe from ungodliness and wickedness and spirits of murder. Anyway, when I was a police officer, I was an anointed police officer. The Holy Spirit enabled me to find people doing crime at a level that was way, way ahead of any of my other fellow officers. That's a good thing for the public, everybody. Goodness gracious. Gee whiz. Wow, we're really quiet in here. And not only that, but you know what? The Holy Spirit filling me was filling me with the spirit of the fear of the Lord. And so the Holy Spirit on the inside of me enabled me to be a good police officer and a kind police officer and a just police officer and a compassionate police officer. So much so, and I give the glory to the Lord, so much so that after I finished being a police officer and went to Bible college, in my first vacation back home to my hometown, I walked in 6 months later, I walked into our church, no, maybe 3 months later, I walked into our church, and there was my atheist custody sergeant. Okay, the custody sergeant is the man or the woman who's the first person that you meet at the jailhouse, at the police station, when you're a police officer, and you bring in somebody that you've arrested on suspicion of such and such and so. You bring them in, and the custody sergeant's job is to sign the suspect or the arrested person, to sign them in, first of all, to do a quick interview with the police officer, make sure that it was a lawful arrest, make sure that the person's, you know, that it was right to bring them in, otherwise they're immediately released. And so, you know, you have to tell the custody sergeant a brief account of what's happened and why you've brought them in. And the custody sergeant decides, yes, okay, we'll sign them in. And they fill everything out. And my custody sergeant, every day that I was on duty, because we were in the same shift, every day for 3 years was there when I would bring the customers. When I would bring the... When I would bring the folks that had been arrested, that I had arrested, I would bring them in and he would sign them in. He was an atheist. He wanted nothing to do with the gospel. He wanted nothing to do with Jesus. He would never listen to the gospel, was not open at all. I was so shocked when I walked into church, my home church, and there he was. First time I'd ever seen him in civvies, for starters. So that was a shock. Dressed like an atheist as well. And I looked at him and I thought, wow, what in the world is Sergeant doing in here? And I went up to my pastor and I said, Pastor, is that Sergeant so-and-so? He said, yes, it is. And he's, you know, I knew that they had been friends. I said, what's he doing in the church? He's an atheist. Not anymore, he's not, Duncan. Why? How did that happen? What did you guys do that I couldn't do for 3 years? Oh no, Duncan. He came, he phoned me up, and he said, Derek, how do I become a Christian? I want to give my life to Jesus. Because, and Derek said, well, why? Why all of a sudden are you wanting to give your life to Jesus? He said, because I've seen undeniable evidence. I watched PC 2055 Smith for 3 years bring person after person after person, prisoner after prisoner after prisoner, and he treated every one of them with dignity, with honor, with compassion. And I cannot deny the existence of God because I've seen him in the way PC 2055 Smith honored them. I saw Jesus in that uniform. And he gave his life to Jesus. Now, the reason I'm telling you all of that, folks, is to say this. We have been on a journey as a whole movement in Catch the Fire. We've been on a journey here in Toronto and in Raleigh and many other places and many other of our churches. And we're being helped by men like Dr. Ed Silvoso, who has been on an incredible journey himself, having been one of the fathers, founding fathers of the revival in Argentina. And Dr. Ed Silvoso is helping the church all over the world to lift its eyes up and to realize that we're actually called as the church to transform our cities, everybody. We're not called to be the holy huddles in our churches. We're called to be the salt and the light. We're called to be the manifestation of Jesus in uniform. We're called to be the manifestation of Jesus in our families, in our communities, in our coffee shops, in our supermarkets, everywhere that we go. We're called to be the manifestation of the King and the Kingdom. And we're not called to churchianity. We're called to Christianity. And Christianity is not so much for us alone, it's for the world. Because God so loved the church that he gave his only son, that whoever believes in him should have eternal life. No? For God so loved the world. The world. And he doesn't say, and then by the way, the world right there is cosmos. He loves all of it. He sent his son for the world, everybody. He is convinced that his son won the world back to himself. He won it all. He didn't just win the people. He won all the systems. He won the systems of government. He loves getting involved in the systems of government. You know, when I look at our nations right now, I look at Canada's government, I look at the United States government, I look at the UK government, I look at governments all over the world, and I sit there scratching my head, and I can only keep coming back to the Apostle Paul saying, pray for your governments. First of all, pray for them. Lift them up. Why? Because they're instruments in God's hand for righteousness in your lives and for goodness towards you. And so we've been coming into this revelation, but there's been something niggling me on the inside. It's just kind of been a little bothering me, just a little bothering me, because I'm trying to see where does the river of God, where does the intimacy of the bride, the bridal paradigm and the message of the soon coming king, where does that fit in with this groundswell movement that's happening all across the church right now, where God's turning the church inside out and causing the church to fall in love with the world, to not the world as in the world, that kind of falling in love with the world. I'm talking about falling in love with the world the way God loves the world and loving the world back to life and transforming our cities. And I realized yesterday in the worship We've had 22 years in this revival, and it's been the most magnificent 22 years, whoa, of fire, 22 years of wine, 22 years of wine, of new wine. We've been so drunk, we've not been able to walk. People have had to carry us. We've had people that have been drunk and overcome and overwhelmed like Heidi Baker for 7 days and then gone out and transformed Mozambique. We've had just millions and millions. I honor my pastors, John and Carol, tonight, and all of the team here in Toronto, and Gordon and Kathy, the School of Ministry, literally thousands of students, and thousands of people, millions of people, that have been affected by these 22 years of revival that we've been in, coming into 22 years. And God has poured out his spirit in an unprecedented way, certainly for my generation. I would say it's the greatest outpouring that I know of in my generation. Why? Because he's preparing his bride. Because he's preparing her in love for the King. He's preparing her and getting her ready for his return. And the church has been, I want to talk about the church. I grew up in the evangelical church. My parents were missionaries in Nigeria for 20 years. I grew up in church, and church was so boring. We slept, or we pleaded with God to let us sleep. I grew up a strict Baptist kid. And the Lord showed me today as I was waiting on him that the church, the universal church across the body of Christ, has by and large been like Queen Vashti, who, when the king Ahasuerus prepared a giant feast, and at the end of the feast, when it was at its highest point and the wine was flowing like no other moment, and he called for his bride and she refused to come from her own party. And I feel like the Lord was saying, the church of today is by and large like Queen Vashti, Duncan. And I'm looking for a bride like Esther. I'm looking for a bride who will be willing to be prepared for months and months in all kinds of intimacy, in oil of intimacy, so that she's ready to be married to the king. And I'm looking for a bride that when she's married to the king, will not use her marriage to the king for herself. I'm looking for a bride that will realize that just like Queen Esther, that she's been chosen to be married to the king, not so much for herself, but actually for the sake of the king and for the sake of her people who were the king's people. And I feel like the Lord is wanting to say to this church, my scepter is extended to you. And I'm looking for the ones that are not fearful of me. I'm looking for the ones that know that I'm good. I'm looking for the ones that know and understand that I'm kind and that I'm compassionate and I'm full of loving kindness and that gentleness is my greatest asset. And I'm looking for a bride that will represent me to the world the way I really am, and save my people. And I realized the first 22 years, we've been like Esther, being prepared to be married to the king. But the next 20 years, my grandson will be 20. And I realize the next 20 years is completely different, everybody. The next 20 years is about the bridal, is about the bride having made herself ready, having been made ready by the Holy Spirit, beginning to enter into Something that is reserved in the future for a distant day, another day when we'll truly be married to him. But he's looking for those who get a glimpse of that, who begin to start to rule with him, will respond to the scepter, and will begin to come on behalf of his people that are out there in the world, and will begin to raise their gaze on the city, and will want to actually bring the people of God that are in the city into the kingdom and transform the cities, but not for the sake of the cities, but for the sake of the bridegroom who's about to return. And I realize that's what's been bothering me, because God is wanting to bring transformation in the cities, but it's not just for the sake of the city, so that we can all enjoy living in a city that's full of righteousness, full of peace, and full of joy. Although that's amazing and that'll be great, but it's something better, something eternal, something much more, infinitely better. It's so that the bride is a fat, fat bride. He doesn't want to marry a skinny, scrawny bride, especially one that refuses to come to the party. He wants to marry a big, fat bride. And the Lord reminded me this afternoon, in the moment in Revelation 21, where the angel says, "Come with me, John, and I will show you the bride." And he's caught up in the spirit away to a very high mountain. And he sees the bride, and the bride is a city. It's a city. Is your city ready for her bridegroom? Because he's looking to turn your city into the New Jerusalem. Now, don't get me wrong, everybody. I know that there's the New Jerusalem. Don't get me wrong. I know that there's going to be the ultimate city of God. But you know what? I've realized I want to start pastoring my city so that something of what's reserved for that day is enjoyed in this moment, in this generation. That we see something of that New Jerusalem. We see something, we get glimpses of that. Why? So that the city of Raleigh and the city of Toronto can be ready for the return of the King. And I realize, I thank God with all my heart for Dr. Ed Silvoso, for the message that's lifted our gaze away from just on our church and onto our whole city, for the transformation of our cities. But yesterday, the Lord showed me it's all actually not just for the sake of the transformed cities. It's actually for the sake of the return of the King. He's looking for his bride. 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 I want you to turn with me, because there's nothing that will transform your city more than the power and the presence of God. So turn with me to the book of Acts chapter 5. Acts chapter 5. Now, remember in John 14, 12, Jesus said to his disciples, "I tell you the truth, truly, truly I say to you, not only will you do the thing, whoever believes in me, not only will they do the things that I do, but even greater things will they do in my name, because I go to the Father." Now, for a full explanation of what I feel Jesus is saying there, of what the key is to the greater works, you need to read my book called Consumed by Love, because I don't have time to explain all that. But what I want to say tonight, my job tonight is to just make you incredibly hungry and incredibly thirsty for more than what you currently have. One of the saddest verses that I've read in a very long time. I have a habit, I've been doing it now for 28 years, of reading the Bible through each year from cover to cover. And it's amazing to me how doing that, you miss so much. And then all of a sudden, something that you've read, I don't know how many times, dozens of times, just leaps off the page at you, and you're like, oh my goodness gracious. And I was sitting down in North Carolina on a beautiful day, on my porch, on my rocking chair. Looking out at the horse in the paddock, that thank God's not my horse, but it is on my land. But my friend needed a paddock for a horse. Kate and I wanted a horse in a paddock. Then we don't have to cut the grass. Not only that, we get to watch a horse and never have to go anywhere near it. I love it. I'm a farmer's boy and I've had to clean up an awful lot of poop. And a horse makes a lot of poop. And as I'm sitting on my porch, looking at my friend's horse, it's my favorite thing, you know. It does. I didn't know horses did that so much. Golly. Wow, the Lord afflicted them with that kind of communication. How are you doing? Anyway, and I'm reading about Uzziah. And Uzziah, in 2 Chronicles 26, Uzziah is a good king. And you know what? When you get to Uzziah, you're just so grateful that Uzziah was a good king. Because you've been reading all these different kings and you're like, oh, another. And so-and-so was wicked. And then you get to Uzziah and Uzziah did what was right in the eyes of the Lord. And whatever Uzziah walked with God, he prospered. Whatever Uzziah remembered the Lord his God, he prospered. Whatever Uzziah was walking with God, the Lord strengthened him. And then it gets to this devastating verse that just arrested my heart in a way that only the Word of God can. Just went right to my heart like a sword. It said this in verse 16. It said this. And when Uzziah became strong, his heart became proud to his destruction. It just broke my heart right there. I just put my Bible down. I just was broken, heartbroken. It's like, God, the very thing that you long, that you become strong. Through all the brokenness and all the weakness, those days being over, finally Israel, having turned, being set free from their enemies, now has all these fortresses. He becomes a man, so much peace that he can become a man of the soil. He loved gardening. And then it says, when Uzziah became strong, his heart became proud to his destruction. And all of a sudden, the Holy Spirit just spoke to me and I realized the thing that grieves God about pride is not just that pride in and of itself is inherently evil, which it is. But that's the, you know, as a strict Baptist growing up in the evangelical church, oh, pride. Oh, pride. God opposes the proud, gives grace to the humble. And aren't we so humble? Humble missionaries, serving the Lord for 30 years. Yes, yes. Humble, very humble. Our best part about ourselves is our humility, actually. I realized in that moment that what really grieves God about pride is that pride is the number one thing that keeps us from the next level of goodness that a perfect God wants to manifest to us. And it causes us to settle. It causes us to feel that we've arrived. It causes us to say, wow, we're doing so good. This is amazing. Thank you, Lord. We've asked you for more all these years, and we've arrived and we've got the more. And we have no idea that that mentality is cutting us off from so much more that God's got for us. Pride cuts us off from the more of a good God. And just pierced my heart. And I just began to realize, it shook me up, it woke me up, it made me realize, wow, all the things that I consider a success in my life, those things that God has done, wonderful as they are, may they never hold me back from a heart that yearns for even more of God. May they never hold us back from the more of God, because God is so good. And I began to realize that God is motivated against pride because he's good. It's the very goodness of God that he wants to release us from pride. It's not that he's got a big stick wanting to beat us up because we've been proud. It's not that. It's not because pride is so inherently evil, although it is. It's really because pride prevents us from discovering how fantastically good God is. He's got so much more for us. And Acts chapter 5, verse 12 is one of those passages of scripture that is a really good antidote to pride. It's just one of those little passages of scripture that makes us realize, wow, God's got just so much more for us. I just have not arrived yet. There's so much more that my city can enjoy of God that I'm currently bringing to it. Verse 12. And through the hands of the apostles, everybody say hands.
Hands.
Hold out your hands a minute. Just look at them in front of you like this. Those hands, perhaps slightly wrinkly, soon to be grandfather hands. It's okay, I'm getting used to it. Those hands are dangerous, everybody. Look at your hands and say, hands, hear the word of the Lord. You were created to be dangerous to the dominion of darkness. Woo. Look at this. And through the hands, everybody say hands. Of the apostles, many signs and wonders were done among the people, and they were all with one accord in Solomon's porch. Yet none of the rest dared join them, but the people esteemed them highly. Can you imagine? We would never have to have seeker-sensitive churches if our hands began to flow with the power of God. In fact, if our hands began to flow with the power of God, we'd have a brand new dynamic that the early church knew, but we are not so familiar with, that would begin to happen to us, whereby the entire city was scared out of their wits to join us. How about that for a church growth strategy? Just get so much of God, and just let the power of God flow through you that everybody in Winnipeg is terrified to join them in Catch the Fire Winnipeg because they've heard that there's so much power among them. And people are literally scared that they're going to meet the living God when they meet you. What would your church community look like, everybody, if God took up so much residence among you, of his manifest presence among you, that the entire city was terrified to even come anywhere near your church? Well, you say, well, wait a minute. How are we going to transform a city if they're all scared of us? Watch this. Verse 13, yet none of the rest dared join them, but the people esteemed them highly, and believers were increasingly added to the Lord. Multitudes of both men and women. Now, multitudes is one of those words that the book of Acts is just jammed full of. The book of Acts is jammed full of the word multitudes. It just keeps coming up over and over again. Multitudes, 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 multitudes. Normal Christianity is multitudes being saved. Now, it's easy for me to say that on this platform. And I can't tell you that multitudes are being saved at Catch Fire Raleigh yet. But I tell you what, we want that with all of our hearts. That's what we're aiming for. And I want to encourage you, no matter what church you're part of, I want you to get hold of God and just say, God, it is normal Christianity that multitudes getting saved is our experience. And I put a demand on you, God, that you would once again cause your word to come to pass and let multitudes in my city get saved, because I know it's your will, because you want a fat bride. Duncan Smith said it. Maybe I should say voluptuous or something, it'd be better. But you understand what I'm meaning. He wants a full bride, everybody. You understand what I'm saying by that, don't you? Please don't misunderstand me when I say a fat bride. I'm talking about a bride that's full, because the full number of billions of people are now part of the bride. Are you following me now? It's a big city. And believers were increasingly added to the Lord, multitudes of both men and women, so that they brought the sick out into the streets and laid them on beds and couches. Okay, back then they didn't have electric wheelchairs. They, come to think of it, they didn't even have manual wheelchairs. They just had beds and couches. They had mats and things. But if this was today, it would be a bit like this. This is how it would go. Through the hands of the apostles and through the hands of Catch the Fire Toronto, many signs and wonders were done among the people, and they were all in one accord, yet none of the rest of Toronto dared join them. But the people of Toronto esteemed them highly, and believers were increasingly added to the Lord. Multitudes were flocking to the church in Toronto, both men and women. I like the way it says both men and women, because right now there's far too many women in the church. But it says right here that the normal standard of the early church, which is the standard, God set the standard with the early church, the normal standard is both men and women getting saved. And we're believing God for men flocking into the kingdom. And it says, so that they brought the sick out into the streets, bringing them in their electric wheelchairs and bringing them in their manual wheelchairs and bringing them in their hospital beds, because there was such a rush on, they just rolled the entire bed out. Whole ambulances were being deployed to bring people to this location of 272 Atwell Drive, because it was heard in the hospitals that there's power in the church building, because God's at work among his people and people are leaping out of their wheelchairs that are quadriplegics from the neck downwards. And that's what the scriptures say was normal in Jerusalem. Normal. People that were sick. Imagine if you began to get so much of God on you. Imagine if you individually began to get so much of God on you. We know he's in you for you, but I'm talking about the anointing on you for the world. Imagine if you began, and your ministry, and for witnessing. Imagine if you got so much of the Holy Spirit coming on you that you looked like a gigantic Michelin man in the spirit. There was just a giant, great, big, humongous, I don't even know how to describe it. Just this force field of the Holy Spirit, his presence, around you, several feet in diameter, that you were just so anointed with God, you'd spent so much time with him in the secret place asking for his presence, that he says, okay, seeing as you're hanging out with me in the secret place, I will hang out with you in the public place. And you have so much of God on you that you walk into an elevator and you press the button to go to the 16th floor, and three or four flight attendants come in with you after an exhausting flight all the way from Vancouver. And by the time it goes ding, for the eighth floor. They've all passed out in the anointing and fallen out in the door, and we're having to quickly scramble them out before the doors close and squish them. Because the glory of God was upon you, and the very air was sucked out of that elevator by the presence of God. I love the story that John tells of Smith Wigglesworth and one guy in New Zealand that heard that nobody of all the pastors in the pre-service prayer meetings could stand it any longer with Smith. And finally, every one of them would just run out. And I remember reading it as well in Apostle of Faith, an incredible book. Finally, there was this one New Zealand pastor who wasn't there, this young guy, and he's like, "No, I know I'm gonna do it. I'm gonna go in that prayer meeting with Smith, and I don't care if it's the last thing. I don't care if I die in there with him. I'm not leaving. All the other pastors can leave, but I'm not leaving." And he goes in there, and he's in there, and they start praying one by one. The glory of God comes, the weighty glory comes. One by one, they all start leaving, people running out, gasping for air, and this pastor's and finally, and he runs out. Because the presence of God was so thick upon Smith. I want that. I want that, Lord. I ask you for that. That you would anoint me with that kind of anointing. And not just me, Lord, but I ask that you'd anoint all of my friends in this room, Lord. Every one of us. That we'd be so anointed, we'd become scary to the world. And yet, irresistibly attractive. Imagine. It says, so that they brought the sick out into the streets, laid them on the beds and couches, that at least the shadow of Peter passing by might fall on some of them. Also, a multitude gathered from the surrounding cities to Jerusalem, bringing sick people, and those, there it is again, a multitude gathered from the surrounding cities, everybody. You talk about city transformation. When your city begins to get shaken by the power of God that's on the church, and the church realizes that the presence and power and person of Jesus is not for themselves, but it's for the world. That the Holy Spirit and the anointing of the Holy Spirit is not for us all to just have a jolly party alone, but it's actually for the whole world to get saved. When that kind of power starts getting unleashed, not only will your city be transformed, but all the surrounding cities are going to get transformed. People from Hamilton are going to start flocking here. People from Oshawa are going to start flocking from here. People from Barrie are going to start flocking. People are going to hear it about it in North Bay. They're going to start flocking. People that were in America are going to start flocking. How do we know that? It's already happened. It happened in 1994 and it's continued to happen. We know that it can happen. We've witnessed it. We've experienced it. But by and large, it was mainly the church that came. It was the Esthers that came. In the church. The Vashtis all said no, but the Esthers said yes. And they're literally walking in their union with their king. And now the scepter of the king is out for all of those Esthers to turn around and say, "Lord, would you save my city? Would you save Toronto? Would you save my city of Hamilton? Would you save my city of New York? Would you save my city of Philadelphia? Lord, would you save my city of Chicago? Lord, would you save my city of LA? Would you save my city of Hollywood? Would you save my city of Mumbai? Save Mumbai, Lord. Would you save my city of Mecca?" God is looking for a bride that have his heart to save her people, like Esther. Also, a multitude gathered from the surrounding cities to Jerusalem, bringing sick people and those who were tormented by unclean spirits. And then look at this. And they were all healed. Oh. Come on, everybody. Did you just hear that? They were all healed without exception. Every one of them was healed. There was so much power that every single person was healed. They didn't have to explain, oh, we're sorry that your cancer didn't get healed, but, you know, just keep in faith, just have faith in God, not the outcome. No, they didn't even have to talk like that. They didn't have to come up with theologies and doctrines to explain the lack of power. Because all were healed. All were healed. Oh, I want that, Murray. I want that, Ash. I want that in Raleigh. I want that in the worst way. That's what I want. I don't want to be like any other church. I want to be like Jesus. Now, and just turn over to Acts 19. I want you to see that this was really normal. It wasn't just for Pete and John Boy and Jimbo. It was also for Paul. It was also for a guy that persecuted the church. God anointed a man who persecuted the early church and did everything in his power to destroy it. And God saved him and anointed him with so much power, it gives you hope that you can carry that kind of power. Because if he could anoint a man who breathed murderous threats and destroyed the church, some say he was a murderer, we don't know, there's no record that he murdered anybody, but he certainly approved of Stephen's death. We know that. And look at this. Look how God anointed him. Now, God worked unusual miracles by the hands of Paul. Say hands. There it is again. Come on, everybody. Take your hands out again. Your little hands. Just your little hands. Just look at those hands. I want you to realize that those are the hands of the Trinity. You are the living headquarters of the Trinity on the earth. You have very, very dangerous hands. Your hands were created to be dangerous. Your hands were created to drive out demons. Your hands were created to drive out sickness. Your hands were created to raise the dead. Your hands were created to win the bride. Your hands were created to win the bride, everybody. Now, God worked unusual miracles by the hands of Paul so that even handkerchiefs or aprons were brought from his body to the sick. And the diseases left them, and the evil spirits went out of them. Wow! Can you imagine God pouring out so much of his spirit on you that your whole neighborhood starts, that you get a reputation in your entire neighborhood that people start sneaking your laundry off the washing line? You take your jacket off, and you leave your jacket on a restaurant chair, and somebody sneaks up behind and takes it, not because they're a thief, but because they're so convinced in the anointing that you're carrying, the anointing that's upon your life, they're so convinced of it that they have come up with the idea that even your jacket will satisfy the demand of the hungry. That even your jacket will release the power of God. Clothing is one of the things that spends the most time on an anointed human being. And that clothing gets saturated in the other clothing that you're wearing, the Holy Spirit. And that clothing gets so saturated in the anointing in your life that that clothing can become one of the greatest conduits of the kingdom of heaven and can cause a quadriplegic to come racing out of their wheelchair. How hungry are you? Are you like Uzziah, who became strong and your heart became proud and you didn't even know it was pride because you were too busy thinking you were humble and everybody else is proud? But really the reality is God calls it pride. Why? Because that mentality is limiting you from the next level of glory that God wants to pour out on your life. Abba. Oh, Holy Spirit, I ask you for true grace and humility in our hearts, Lord, that we would realize that there's just so much more that you want to give us, so much more power, Lord, that you want to satisfy us with, so that we can truly reach the world, so that we can truly transform our cities, so that we can truly present our cities as the bride to the bridegroom. So that your love would be manifested all over this world. I want to just take a moment. That story of Peter really gets me. The reason it gets me is because I just think about how much of God Peter was carrying. That if you look at that scripture in Acts chapter 5, it wasn't Peter who came up with the idea that his shadow could heal. It was people that didn't even believe in Jesus that came up with the idea, I can't get to Peter because there's such a giant crowd thronging. I can't get my paralyzed friend. I can't get my friend with diabetes to Peter. I can't get my friend with Parkinson's disease to Peter. I can't get my friend with cerebral palsy to Peter. I can't get my friend with autoimmune deficiency diseases to I can't get my friend to Peter with autoimmune deficiencies. I can't reach him. But there's something about Peter. There's so much power flowing from Peter. I've heard so many of my friends saying that their relatives were healed by that man. There's so much of God on him. I can just see God all over him. I don't understand it. I can't work it out. I've never been taught about it. I just know that if I could just put my friend in the pathway, I know that his shadow will heal my friend. His shadow. I thought about it today. I thought about it. God created this world in such a way that he's given us a shadow. Why? So that even our shadows could be filled with the light of the glory of God and could satisfy the demand of the hungry and thirsty for God. That's why you have a shadow. And I began to realize, what would it look like if our shadows suddenly became one of the most dangerous things in the entire city? I tell you one thing, they wouldn't be very dangerous if we stay indoors the whole time. It really helps the Lord to create a shadow worthy of his presence if you're out in the sunlight or in some kind of light. And I honestly, I don't want to be cute about it. I really feel like the Lord is literally saying, it's time for us to realize that the best days of the church are outside of the four walls. That the best place for the power of God to flow is outside of our four walls. The book I wrote, Consumed by Love, I was trying to think of something that I could write in the front. I'd read a book and it had a line in the front that summarized the whole book, and I thought, wow, I really like that. I'd like a line that would draw in whoever it was that would pick up my book in the bookstore or whatever and would look at it and think, oh, I wonder what this book, I've never heard of Duncan Smith. Well, Consumed by Love, yeah, that's kind of cool. I think one of my favorite stories was Ruth, who was leading worship here. She was so excited. In the first week that the book was published, she said that one of her friends was at university and was sitting at university, and while the lecture was going on, was reading my book. And she was so caught up reading this book, she was so on fire reading this book, and her friend next to her, who wants nothing to do with Jesus, would never let her talk about Jesus, because she's a New Age, you know, I don't know if she was New Age or whether she was whatever it was that she was totally an unbeliever and just into whatever, typical kind of person of that generation, actually, right now at university. And she just leaned over and she said, what are you reading? She said, oh, I'm reading this book. It's called Consumed by Love. I want that book. What do you mean you want that book? I want it. Well, you can get it. No, I want that book right now. What do you mean you want that book right now? I want your book right now, in the middle of the lecture. So she's like, okay, gave her the book. And I wanted it so that somebody like that could just read one line and understand what the whole book was about. I'm not sure if it was helpful for her, but anyway, it said I waited for, it took me quite a few hours to figure out, and I realized what it was. I, I realized it was the fact that I was burning in my heart about the shadow thing. And I wrote, to all those who are longing for the world to rediscover that even our shadows can heal the sick. See, it's our shadows healing the sick is meant for the world, not the church. So, that's it, folks. That's all I want to preach tonight. I hope I've made you hungry. How many of you would like that kind of power? I want you just to stand up right now onto your feet. And I just don't talk to anybody right now. Just close your eyes and I say don't talk to anybody. I say it with all due respect. Just because I want you to stay in the spirit right now. Oh, because God wants to do something in this room that's very special. Where I believe that God is going to pour out his spirit on us tonight in such an unprecedented way that he's going to start anointing us with so much anointing that our clothing is going to be forced to carry it. Our shadows are going to be forced to carry it. Our whole communities are going to be forced to carry it. And I believe that God is going to just begin to work so powerfully in your life that you become the most dangerous doctor in the whole hospital. You become the most dangerous nurse in the whole hospital. You become the most dangerous police officer in the police force. You become the most dangerous fire person in the fire department. You become the most dangerous lawyer. You become the most dangerous educator. You become the most dangerous teacher. You become the most dangerous pastor. You become the most dangerous church member. You become the most dangerous grandma. You become the most dangerous grandfather. Let me tell you something, everybody, okay? The Word of God says in Psalm 92, around about verse 13, 14, it says, those who are planted in the house of the Lord shall flourish in the courts of their God. They'll be fresh and green and full of sap and will bear fruit even into old age. Do you know something that God says? He says, my power is made perfect through weakness. And I began to realize that he's designed it that the older we get, the weaker our bodies become in the natural, the more anointing we can carry, the more dangerous we become. And I don't want to offend anybody or any preachers that have preached this week, but let me tell you something. Putting old people down is not a good idea. Because God has ordained it in such a way that it's not just young people that can do dangerous things. In fact, he's ordered it so that actually the older you get, the more likely you are to flow in what really makes you dangerous, and that is God himself. And you won't be operating in your own chutzpah and your own youthful strength, but you'll be operating in an altogether more lovely kind of strength that comes from a lifelong fellowship with the King of Glory, where he anoints you on your older body, on your aging body, with so much glory. Paul was an older man at this point, and there was so much power on him, that even though he was a grandfatherly age, he was the most dangerous man in all of Ephesus. So quit behaving like I've been behaving about being a grandparent, and quit behaving that somehow or other because you're, you know, over 50 years old or 60 years old or even 70 years old or even 80 years old, that somehow or other life is over. No. You're just getting started. You're just getting warmed up. You're just getting ready for the greatest anointing you have ever carried in your life. And you know what else? You know what else I've discovered? I've discovered that nobody can be rude to a grandparent. Not only that, I've discovered that grandparents can get away with things that they could never get away with when they were parents. And grandparents can do things that their wayward children don't want them to do. And there are some of you in this room, and you have children that are not walking with God. Okay? Well, first of all, tonight, in the mighty name of Jesus, we call to the north, the south, the east, and the west, and we call every one of them home in Jesus' name. Secondly, I feel that there are some of you, you have children that are not walking with God, and it grieves you in your heart. because they've turned away from the Lord. Well, you know what? Maybe for whatever reason, your kids no longer give you the right to speak to them. But I tell you what, you can go after your grandbabies. Oh yeah, you can go after those grandbabies, because those grandbabies belong to you. They've got your DNA. And for whatever reason you find yourself no longer able to speak into your kids' lives, I tell you what, give your grandchildren everything that you wish you could have given your kids. Just pour it into them. Love on them. Tell them about the kingdom. Tell them about the gospel. Tell them about how powerful their shadows can become. Tell them about how powerful their clothes can become. Tell them about the glory of the king. Tell them that they were created to do dangerous things with the living God. Tell them that they can have dreams and visions. Tell them that they can speak in tongues. Tell them that they can interpret tongues. Tell them that they can prophesy. Teach them all the things that your parent, your children, their parents don't want you to ever teach them. Teach them anyway. Folks, if you're looking for the anointing of the Holy Spirit to come upon you in the way that Paul was carrying or the way that Peter was carrying, if you're looking for your shadow to become so effective that people jump out of wheelchairs when your shadow touches them, if that's what you're looking for tonight, you're in the right place. You're going to get it. God is going to graciously give it to us all tonight. I want you to step out of your seats and I just come rushing up here to the front. Let's push it, and just not too much of a standing, but just come out here to the front, fill the whole of this area up, squeeze in tight. I tell you, God is no respecter of persons. God's not looking. You don't have to be somebody who's on this platform to be greatly used by God for your shadow to heal. You don't have to be like that. You've got your own platform. Your platform could be your kitchen sink. Your platform could be your kitchen table. Your platform could be the boardroom in your business. You know what? Some of you, the Lord showed me that some of you are the owners of your own business. You're the owners of your own business, and you're a scaredy cat to teach your people the gospel. Wow. How dumb is that? That's the dumbest thing ever. You're their employer. If they get upset, give them a pay rise. For goodness sakes, you're the boss. Give them no rest. Tell them about the king. Tell them about the kingdom. Tell them about the glory of God. Just make a decision tonight. Lord, you've made me the boss of my life. And I surrender that leadership to you because you're actually the boss of my life. Thank you that I'm a vice president. Thank you that I've reached the top of my tree. And God, I'm sorry that I've been a little intimidated by everybody around me, but from now on, oh God, I just give you my whole life. I give you my whole life. Every hour of my working day, I give to you. Would you come and presence yourself upon me so greatly that my shadow is forced to carry your presence? Folks, just begin to lift up your voices right now. I can't do this for you. I can't do it. I can't do it, but you've moved. That's all you needed to do was move. You've moved tonight, and you're there, and you've moved, and God sees you, and he's gonna answer the cry of your heart tonight. Just begin to raise up your voices. Just begin to cry out to him. Give him no rest. Oh God, I'm gonna give you no rest until you fill me and anoint me with so much power. My shadow is able to heal the sick. My shadow, my shadow, my shadow. My shadow, God, I give you my shadow. I give you my shadow. Every moment that I'm in the sunlight, I give you my shadow. Let the sunlight shine. Let the sunlight shine. Let the light of the sun 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 shine. The light of the sun shine. The light of the sun shine. The light of the sun shine on me. 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 Make me dangerous in uniform. Make me dangerous in uniform. Make me dangerous in uniform. Make me dangerous. 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 God, I give you my hands. I give you my hands. I give you my hands. I give you my time. I give you my time. I give you my grandbabies. I give you my grandbabies. I give you my grandbabies. I give you my grandbabies, God. I give you my children, God. I give you my church, God. I give you my church. I give you all my leaders. I give them all to you. I give you my church. I let go of it. It's not mine, it's yours. It's not mine, it's yours. It's not mine, it's yours. Pour out your spirit, God. Pour out your spirit upon me. Wreck me, ruin me, wreck me, ruin me, ruin my reputation. Mess me up, good God. Don't ever let me be like Vashti, Lord. Don't ever let me worry about Vashti. I don't want to worry about Vashti's and what Vashti's think of me anymore. I don't want to worry anymore about what the world thinks of me because I'm anointed. God, I just want your fire. I want your fire. I want your fire. I want your fire. I want fire in my shadow. I want fire in my shadow. I want fire in my clothes. I want fire in my jeans. I want fire in my jeans. I want fire in my sneakers. I want fire, fire, fire. I want fire, God. I want fire all over me, God. I want fire all over me, God. I want fire, fire, God. Fire for the nations. Fire for the bride. 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 Fire for my city, God. Fire in my shadow for the city, God. I just want it, God. I want it with all my heart. I want you with all my heart. I want you with all my heart. I want you with all my heart. I want you, God. I want you, God. I want you to occupy my shadow. I want you to occupy so much of me that even my shadow is completely saturated with your glory. I want so much of your presence, God, that even my shoes are dripping with glory. Even my socks are dripping with glory. Even my underwear is dripping with glory. I just want my jacket dripping with glory. I want every part of me dripping with glory, God. I want to drip with glory, God. I want to drip with your glory, God. I want the seat in the airplane after I leave dripping with glory. I want every person who sits in every airplane seat after me. I want them totally overwhelmed with your presence. I want them totally overcome with your glory. I want your glory and the knowledge of your glory, God, to follow me, to follow me, to follow me. I want signs and wonders to follow me. I want them to follow me, God. Oh, that you would just change me, God. Just change me. Take me out of mediocrity into glory, God. Into fiery glory, God. Into fiery glory, God. Oh, I give you my whole life. My whole life, God. Oh, Shandara Baba. Anytime you guys want to just help me out, take over, do whatever, you have that fire. You have it. You have it in spade loads. You have it in absolute spade loads. You have it in spade loads. God, give us spade loads of anointing, spade loads, unrecoverable levels of anointing, God, critical levels of anointing, anointing that causes us literally to be like dead people walking, fully alive in Christ Jesus, totally dead to the world, dead to reputation, dead to time. Whoa, no longer wooed by money, no longer wooed by money. Hoo-ah.
We want to see you shine, shine, shine like the sun. You're waking us to life. You've only begun every fear.
That's it, we've only begun.
Disappears when you shine.
It's just the beginning, everybody. This is just the beginning.
We want to see you
shine, yeah, 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 yeah.
Shine like the sun. You're waking us to life.
Shandaraba. Shine on our shadows.
Shine, shine, shine like the stars. You are the first love to open my heart. Every hope, every dream comes alive when you shine on us.
You know, I wonder what the Apostle Peter, I wonder what he was thinking the day that his shadow first began to heal. And he entered into that realm that Jesus was talking about, where he said, Eve, I tell you, those who believe in me, not only will they do the things that I do, but even greater things. There's no record that Jesus' shadow healed anybody. And I wonder whether Peter, I wonder if he could have looked down 2,000 years of Christianity. Within the first few days of the Holy Spirit being poured out, the world discovered that Christian shadows can heal the sick. I wonder if Peter would have just wept uncontrollably for days on end if he could have got a glimpse of where the church would be at 2,000 years later, when the world was supposed to have discovered even more innovative ways of making a demand on the anointing. The world no longer made up any innovative ways of demanding the anointing on the lives of the church, because the church dried up and withered up and no longer carried the glory of her King. And the world lost its faith, the world lost its hope, the world lost its innocence of being convinced that everybody would be healed. And folks, I don't know about you, but I want to be somebody who leads the way in this generation of a whole generation in the world rediscovering that true Christianity is about being in Christ. It's about Christ being in us. It's about God dwelling with his people. It's about impossibility becoming the passion for the church to make it possible. God, I ask that you'd supercharge us with love tonight. I ask that you'd supercharge us with faith tonight. I ask that you'd supercharge us with the anointing, with the Holy Spirit, and with power, with fire, with the very person. That we be your best friends. That we would represent the bridegroom. That we be the bride that walks with her bridegroom. That we'd present the bridegroom to the world with such glory and such power, and such kindness, and such goodness, and such compassion, that the world is irresistibly drawn, trembling with the fear of the Lord, yet irresistibly drawn to her King, a bride made ready, a glorious bride. Oh, Father, I ask you that in our day, in our generation, more people would give their lives to Christ than any other generation. And that you would restore to us the level of power that you always intended the church to carry. That you caused Dr. Luke to write the book of Acts, not because you wanted to write a historic account of a glory day that would never be repeated, but because you put it in the heart of Dr. Luke to write it as an invitation for every generation to rediscover what's possible with a God of the impossible flowing through them. God, I'm asking you that our text messages would carry your glory. I'm asking you that our emails would carry your glory. I'm asking you that the printed out emails, the text messages arriving to cell phones of those that are sick in hospital, that you would anoint them, that you would anoint them with so much power that people are instantly healed. People with strokes are instantly healed.
Folks, I just feel in the Lord right now that we're literally to ask God together that God would give us victory over certain diseases. And I'm going to call them, we're just going to call them out together, okay? We're just going to all call them out. God, we ask you for power over Parkinson's disease. Parkinson's disease. Power over Parkinson's disease. Just begin to ask God to give you power over Parkinson's disease. That everybody that you ever meet with Parkinson's disease will be instantaneously, gloriously healed because the Lord healed them all. Now we're going to ask for cancer. No, we're not asking for cancer. Let me rephrase that. Now we're going to ask that cancers would be instantly healed through our hands the moment we lay hands on them. God, we're asking you that every time we lay hands on those with cancer, they be instantly healed. That stage 4 cancers would be instantly healed, God, through our hands, through my hands, through my hands, through my hands, God, through my hands, God, in my shadow, God, in my shadow, God, on my watch, in my day, in my church. Fire, burning fire, would quench cancers, would flow through our hands, God. Burning fire. And now we're going to ask for that God would give us victory over quadriplegics, paraplegics, and all wheelchair-bound diseases and conditions. Right now, just begin to ask God. God, I'm asking you, Lord, for so much power that every person that I lay my hands on that cannot feel from the neck downwards, that cannot move from the neck or chest downwards, God, or the waist downwards, God, I'm asking you for power to flow through my hands so that they be instantly healed, that they would get up because you said the lame will walk. And I'm asking you now, Lord, that you'd anoint my hands, that those lame would walk, God, that they would walk, God, that paraplegics would walk. In Jesus' name, quadriplegics would be instantly healed, God. Just ask him for the blind now, the blind. Go and ask him for the blind to be healed. The deaf to be healed, the blind right now. God, I'm asking you for victory over blindness right now, Lord. Victory over the deaf right now, over deafness, over deaf spirits, over mute spirits, God. Oh, shakarabasoto kitarabayende. Rabashikanderebesoto kita. Father, I'm asking you, cerebral palsy, those people suffering with cerebral palsy, that through my hands, God, in my generation, in my day, through my life, through my hands, through my friend's hands, through the church's hands, cerebral palsy would be instantly and totally, completely healed in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name, that you make me famous for healing cerebral palsy, that you heal cerebral palsy through me and my church in Jesus' name. I give you my hands. Let my hands set people free from cerebral palsy. Down syndrome. Oh, that you'd use my hands to deliver people from Down syndrome. Come on, lift up your voices. Ask him for it. I feel like he's saying, whatever you ask right now, it will be yours. Whatever you ask for right now will be yours. Whatever you ask for right now, you can have it. This is a moment in God. Diabetes instantly healed. Type 1, type 2, diabetes instantly healed. Oh, shandarabasoto kitara. Yindarabasoto kitara bayendo. Whatever you ask for in my name, it shall be done for you, says Jesus. Restore majesty, restore majesty, restore majesty, restore majesty, restore majesty, Lord. Restore majesty to the bride. Restore majesty to your people, God. Restore majesty, God. Restored majesty, restored confidence to the world that you will satisfy their demands, God. You will satisfy their draw on the anointing on our lives, God. Restored majesty, restored glory,
right. Shanda rabayende. Oh, shekaraba soto kita rabayende. Rabayende.
Ruth, I just feel that we should sing one more song and then you know, we could. How many of you would like to go to the prayer lines tonight? How many of you would like to go to the prayer lines tonight and have hands laid on you? Okay, good, good, good. Okay, so what we're going to do is, it gets kind of hot when you're all bunched up like that, right? Plus the anointing, that makes you even hotter. Thank you so much, everybody, for just listening to me tonight. Thank you for your good-heartedness. Thank you for your response unto the Lord. Can you just imagine this many people fully loaded with the Holy Spirit? What in the world? What is possible now? You guys are so, you're so dangerous now. What I'm going to ask is that we just sing a song together. You know, let's have the words and everything so we can properly all join in. Sing a song. And then we're just going to go to the prayer lines and, you know, have the prayer ministry team minister to you. And maybe Stu and Chloe, or Stu, Chloe's a mess. You come, I mean, in a good way. She's just totally overwhelmed by God right now. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. I just want to honor Stu and Chloe right here. You know, these are two people that are already living everything I was preaching. I literally know of nobody else like these two, tenaciously going after unprecedented levels of power, not for themselves, but for the glory of the bridegroom, for the return of the king, for the preparation of the bride. And I just love you two so much, and I honor you. They stayed with a man that had no eyes, and they stayed with him, 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 and they just kept praying and just kept praying. Them and the company that are with them in Kenya. And suddenly eyeballs appeared in his empty sockets. Come on, that's what I'm talking about right there. And they left him with three-quarter sized eyes. But how many of you know the Lord is pretty good at finishing off what he started? So I'm sure he finished the miracle. But I just bless the two of you. I bless your shadows beyond your wildest dreams. I bless your shadows, that the glory of God would fill your shadows, that the sunshine would fill your shadows, that you'd be overshadowed with so much of God that your shadows are filled with light and filled with power, and that you become so anointed that you become literally the fear of God enters the city of London and Kakamega, Shandarabayende, and all over London and Europe. Fire is restored to the church through you both. Fire is restored, glory is restored. The world catches fire. The world catches fire through you. The world catches fire through you. The glory of God, the glory of God, the glory of God overshadowing you. Everything spontaneously combusting that you touch. Every single thing that you touch spontaneously combusting with the glory of God. Shandarabayende. Oh, shekarabayende.
Lord, you We're going to move to a time of impartation. And so, you know the drill, there's lines all over the room, down the side, and especially at the back. The ministry team are going to be there. We want to lay hands on as many people as possible. We're going to need a whole pile of catchers. And so if you would like to help us, you get double being a catcher. I honestly think the most important ingredient to me being a leader in the body of Christ is catching for John and Carol for 3 years. And so I want to encourage catching. And so the ministry team are going to go to the back and they're going to have a hand in the air. If you would like to help catch, then just go to someone with their hand in the air, and you can be someone who receives the blessing in double fashion. Because you not only get the overflow of every single prayer, but you get the prayer. You get a prayer session at the end just for you from the ministry team member. So if you want hands laid on you, go to the back, find a line, be patient. There's a whole bunch of people who are going to come, and there's a whole bunch of hands that are going to be laid on you. Other than that, we will see you tomorrow morning. Don't leave until you've been prayed for. But once you've been prayed for, we'll see you tomorrow morning. Some of you may still be here. Who knows?